These huge resources, these that we once believed to be renewable, that our whole human history has led us up to now to believe that are renewable, are not renewable anymore because of what we're doing to them. And so our entire philosophical approach has to change. It's not going to be the same in the future as it was in the past.
Welcome to the second screening of Reactive Film. Tonight we're screening End of the Line, based on a book by the author Charles Clover. And I'm very excited to show everybody this film. I think it's a very, very important subject matter. Basically, we're waging war against the fish, and we're actually winning. By 2048, there's not going to be any fish in the sea. Is that possible? It actually is. This film will really change the way you think and view seafood. Tonight, the Q&A will be with Alexi Zoullas, who is one of the executive producer for End of the Line. So I'm very excited to interview him.
For centuries, the waters in northern Canada teemed with unbelievable amounts of codfish. Legend had it that you could walk across their backs on the water. The cod was so plentiful, the communities thrived on fishing. As the years went on, technology improved. The boats got bigger and catches increased. Then, in 1992, the unthinkable happened. What had once been the most abundant cod population in the world had been fished out of existence.
I've decided that effective at midnight tonight,
there will be a moratorium on harvesting of northern cod until the spring of 1994.
Either we cooperate in addressing it, or there's going to be no fish for anybody.
In 2007, this research vessel set two lines, each with 1,500 hooks, to find out how many cod were left in the waters off eastern Canada. On the first line, they caught one small codfish. On the second, a small basketful. The cod stocks had been depleted to such a low level that they were unable to recover.
My question is, I mean, I saw that Nobu, you know, kind of owned up to what they were doing. But if I go to, like, my local sushi place, I feel like they'll think I'm crazy if I ask questions. Like in Wajima, what do I ask them?
What I've found is if you ask the waiter, especially in a sushi restaurant, they tend to get more confused than normal. The key is really to ask the manager. You know, the poor waiter or waitress might not really have any idea, whereas the management should know. And what we've done is the other producers have created a website that's up and going right now called Fish to Fork. And you can find ratings of all the restaurants that have been rated by consumers, not, you know, government agencies. And so you can go to a restaurant, ask the questions, and even if they can't answer your questions, you can actually write them up either online or you can just take the form in and then post your answers later. And this creates a database. And again, it's like in when you go to school and you get caught doing something you shouldn't be doing, well, you know, they say ignorance is no excuse. Oh, I didn't know, or, you know. So if a restaurant gives you all these lame answers, that is a bad mark against them, and yeah. You can go look it up before you go to these restaurants. It's been very successful in England, where it's kind of started, and now it's coming here. Wow. Well, yeah, because that's the other thing. A lot of people see a movie like this and say, wow, yeah. This is great. I want to change all my eating habits, but I don't know what's sustainable, what's not sustainable. You know, it might not be labeled. So you can go to the Monterey Aquarium, and they have a website, and you can download. We actually printed out some for you guys if you want,
yeah.
Where you can actually look up any fish, and it'll tell you whether it's endangered, why, if it's farmed, why that might be good or bad. There's a lot of information out there now that is readily available.
In 2002, I was in Tunisia, I think it was. And that's when I first sensed that something terribly wrong was happening.
For the last 3,000 years, these men and their forefathers have expected giant bluefin tuna to migrate from the Atlantic Ocean to the Mediterranean Sea. And every spring, the fishermen set their trap, an ancient method of fishing known as the almadraba. The almadraba fishermen once used to catch thousands of bluefin. But over the last 10 years, their catches have declined by 80%.
So there's like this point in the movie where it doesn't really touch on it, but you know, the rise of piracy. Is there some kind of connection between overfishing and the rise of piracy, how like local fishermen are losing their livelihood when huge, you know, big industrial companies are coming in? And like,
what's interesting is, you know, my day job is working in shipping, and we have ships going through the Gulf of Aden, which some of you have probably heard about, has had an incredible surge of piracy. And what a lot of people don't realize is the connections of a lot of these different events globally. The Somali pirates are actually ex-fishermen who started trying to police their own waters from these international fishing fleets that were coming in. And of course, they started by capturing a fishing vessel that was fishing illegally in their waters. Once they realized they could ransom a ship, they said, well, you know, why the hell do we even have to fish anymore? We'll just hijack ships and buy fish like everybody else. So I think what's important, and it goes
seeing
to...
seeing the bigger picture.
Yeah, is seeing the bigger picture and seeing all of our kind of connections to these companies that are pillaging the seas, and to, you know, the fact that we can actually make a change, as you can see in some of the scenes in the movie.
This was the first presentation I'd ever seen about the effect of trawling upon the seabed and upon those creatures that lived on it. And what they said was that trawling with a beam trawler was like plowing a field 7 times a year. And I'm a farmer's son, and I thought to myself, how many crops would grow if you plowed that field 7 times a year? And I thought, not very much at all. And that changed my whole view of what was going on in the sea.
Tell me a little bit about the wastage that happens, because, like, what happens to everything else that you catch in the net?
That's the other problem. You know, some people ask me, they say, well, why are you doing this? Are you, you know, environmentalist? Are you a vegan? These commercial practices are very destructive and also very wasteful. If you're a tuna trawler, right, and you are looking for the most expensive fish to put in your refrigerated vessel, then anything else you catch, you're going to just throw overboard, because it's going to take up space and you're going to be able to get pennies on the dollars. But it's as great as 40% of the overall catch is just discarded every year. And that includes turtles, seagulls, all sorts of marine life. It's really, you know, tragic.
It was when Paulie and his colleagues looked at the reported catches from China that they found their answer.
For every part of the world, the reporting was right, except for Chinese waters.
When Daniel Pauly came to this department, and he said, I think they're wrong. I said, what do you mean they're wrong? He said, well, it can't be that China's catching that much.
And they found that actually, when you looked at the biological productivity of the sea and what we know about it everywhere else, the Chinese figures could not be right. They were just made up. They were made up by communist officials who only got preferment if the graphs went up. Graphs kept going up because they kept making up the figures.
The goal for Reactive Film is to engage and inspire you to these important issues through way of documentaries, as well as to create a dialogue between you and the producer or the writer or even the director of the film, and ultimately inspires you to react to these issues in your life and influence people around you.